I'm in India, in Mumbai, what used to be called Bombay, and behind me is the famous Taj Mahal Hotel. And when I'm in India, of course, I begin to think about Indian chemistry, Indian science. And there are really two things which come to my mind, not necessarily the most important, but the ones that really strike me. One is a tragedy and the other's a triumph. So let's begin with the tragedy, which was the worst chemical accident that's ever occurred. And it happened in the city of Bhopal, which is a long way from here. It's right in the middle of India. And it was due to a discharge of chemicals from a closed chemical factory. It wasn't even making chemicals. It used to make insecticide, but they decided to close it down. And in this factory, which was being decommissioned, there was a tank of a particular chemical known as methyl isocyanate. Isocyanate is a group which contains nitrogen, carbon, and oxygen in a line, NCO. And methyl isocyanate can react with water to generate heat and to generate gases. And you can imagine heat plus gas generates pressure and the tank can blow up. And what is worse, that one of the gases it can generate is hydrogen cyanide, which is very poisonous. And if you breathe it, can kill you at really quite a low dose. So imagine it. In the middle of the night, this reaction took place. And while it was dark, the tank burst and clouds of poison gas spread across the town, across the poorest areas of the town, killing thousands of people. There's still argument whether it was 2,500 or 15,000 people, but an enormous number and injuring a lot more. There are several theories how the water got in the tank, ranging from straightforward misfortune to bad management of the plant or even sabotage. And there's even not quite clear exactly what reaction took place because the products of the reaction depend on the temperature. So the proportion of hydrogen cyanide depends on exactly what temperature the tank broke. Hydrogen cyanide is a very powerful poison because the cyanide group can bind to various molecules in the body. One of the symptoms is that your lips apparently go blue. Fortunately, I've never seen anybody who's died from cyanide poison, but it's a very painful death and very quick. So if you're asleep and breathe hydrogen cyanide, you would be dead before you knew it. It was a terrible tragedy, but it was a wake-up call to the chemical industry across the world. So the suffering of these poor people was not in vain, because nowadays chemical plants are operated far more safely than they were 30 years ago. India is also very famous for one particular physicist, Professor Raman. And Professor Raman worked in Calcutta, now called Kolkata, in Bengal, in the right, very east of India. And he was professor of physics at the university there. And he discovered an effect, which to this day is called the Raman effect, and for which he won the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1930. And the Raman effect is the basis of a very important sort of spectroscopy that is now used all over the world. It's really quite simple, and it's a technique which is now applied to all sorts of chemical reactions and chemical processes. And it involves shining a beam of light which is of a single color, blue or green or red, and shining it onto a sample. And the sample scatters the light, so a large amount of the red light or blue light is scattered back and you can see it. But if you analyze the light very carefully, you also find that there is a small proportion of the light has had its color changed at very discrete frequencies that correspond to the vibrations of the molecule on the substance you're irradiating. And it is these frequencies that give you a signature of the molecule, a sort of fingerprint of the molecule, and allows you to tell what it is. When Raman did it, his first experiments, He did them here in India where the sunshine is very bright, except now in the monsoon season. And this intense light was enough from the sunlight to do the experiments. When I was a student, you had to use huge mercury lamps to get a Raman spectrum, and it took several hours. But after the invention of lasers, then you could use a laser and record a Raman spectrum in a few seconds or even less. So Raman spectroscopy has become enormously important. You can use it for identifying the pigments, the paints that are used in fine art. You can tell if something's a forgery. You can use it for monitoring chemical processes to tell if things are going wrong. And so it is a fantastic discovery that is a credit to India and which is remembered by chemists all over the world.